In this video, I'm going to be covering a lot of the material that's in Unit 5, a lot of the terminology, but I thought, I mean, you could just read it and understand it just fine, but I thought I would go over it as well and give you some examples. Hopefully that will improve your understanding of the different concepts that go along with probability. In this video, we're going to talk again about probability. I'll define probability for you again like I did in the first video. And then we'll talk about what we mean by experiment when we're talking within the context of probability studies. Then we'll talk about outcome or outcomes and the sample space. And then we'll talk about event. And as we go through these different concepts, I'll give you examples and hopefully better illustrate these concepts, help you better understand these concepts. Probability, again, is the chance of an event, like I talked about in the first video. It's mathematically, it's the ratio of the number of observed events or occurrences to the number of possible outcomes or occurrences. Expressed as a numerical measure, it can be expressed as a ratio, a proportion, or a percentage. For working with probabilities, I prefer to use this expression, use proportions to express our probabilities. Percentages are fine. Need to go beyond a ratio, though. Proportion or percentage, preferably proportion, in your homework assignment. If we have zero probability, no chance of the outcome. A probability of 100% that the outcome will occur. The outcome is certain. Probabilities do range from 0.0 to 1.0, expressed as a percentage, from 0% to 100%. Rarely are you going to have 0% probability or 100% probability. I would argue for any event, if there is any shred of possibility that the event could occur, the probability is not zero. For example, what is the probability of the sun exploding, causing the earth to fail? You know, sun explodes, destroys the earth. You'd think 0% probability, but it's not 0%. There is a chance. It's very, very low probability that the sun is going to have an explosion or other type of failure that causes the earth to fail, but there's a chance. 100% probability the sun will rise tomorrow? Yeah, it's really not 100%. There's a chance that it may not rise tomorrow. There's a chance that the sun fails or explodes and causes the earth to fail, and the sun doesn't rise tomorrow. So again, even things that we think are fairly certain, we can't say that there's 0% probability or 100% probability. Very few things are sure things either way. Likelihood is a term that's used interchangeably with the term probability. For example, instead of saying the probability of an event is 0.15%, we could say the likelihood of an event is 0.15%. Same meaning, just different terms used interchangeably. And one thing that's maybe a little bit more challenging for you guys when it comes to probability is the notation and the terminology is not as universally accepted when it comes to probability. You look in different stat textbooks, you see different terminologies being used. And you'll kind of see that as I talk about probability. I'll go with what our textbook uses, but also I'll use some other terms like likelihood and some other terms as well. So yeah, if any of it's confusing to you, let me know. I'll let one of our tutors know, and we'll hopefully get you squared away and get your understanding up to a high level of this particular concept and all the terminology that goes along with it. The first term that I want to talk about that's discussed in your textbook is the term experiment. And I've got experiment in quotation marks because the way we use the term experiment when we're talking about probability studies is not our traditional, conventional usage of this term. We're not talking about a traditional scientific experiment. A traditional scientific experiment is a methodology used for controlling extraneous variables so that we can identify the relationship clearly between the independent and the dependent variable. Experiment in the traditional science research context is a research methodology. But when we use the term experiment and we're talking about probability, an experiment is simply a process or an activity that could yield a variety of results, but only one result at a time. And I'll give you examples of what would be considered experiments from a probability standpoint as we continue through this discussion. But here's the first example. If we are examining the probability of a workplace accident occurring, the experiment is the work process or the work activity where the injury could occur. The experiment is the process that may result in an accident. Some other experiment examples. Flipping a coin. Here we're talking about classical probability, which you'll study in your textbook, and I have another video where I talk about the three methods for assigning probabilities. Flipping a coin from a classical probability standpoint is an experiment. Dealing a single card from a deck of 52 is an experiment that will produce results. Guessing a person's birth month, that could also yield results. Loading a bridge model with a weight to the point of collapse. These are all what we could consider experiments from the probability standpoint. I do need to mention this diagram over here. I showed you this a diagram like this in the previous video, but I didn't talk about it. Fault trees are what we use in my field, safety engineering, and we use fault trees to calculate the probability of an undesired event occurring. And usually there's multiple factors that lead up to an undesired event. We take the probabilities of each of these factors occurring. We combine all of these probabilities to come up with the probability of the top event, or the undesired event that we're focusing on. In this particular example, it's used to calculate the probability of a cooling water loss from a nuclear reactor. If you're in the world of nuclear reactors, you don't want to lose your cooling water. Bad things happen. So safety engineers, nuclear engineers, determine in advance the probability of this type of failure. Then they take measures to reduce that probability as close as they can to zero. And we can never reduce it completely to zero, but we try to implement measures to reduce the probability of this type of failure to a point where it's as close to zero as possible. And these are some different experiments that yield results, activities that yield results. Outcomes are all the possible results that may occur during an experiment. If we think back to our coin flip experiment, the outcome, it's going to be a head or a tail. Dealing a single card from a deck of 52, any one of the 52 cards are possible outcomes. All of the, go ahead and pull this one up here, the collection of all possible outcomes is called the sample space. The sample space for a coin flip is a head or a tail, and the Greek letter omega is used to represent sample space. The sample space, when dealing a single card from a deck of 52, we have 52 different possible outcomes in that sample space. C1, all the way through C52. Guessing a person's birth month, any one of the 12 months make up our sample space. Any one of the 12 months are outcomes. All of those different outcomes make up our sample space. Now, collapsing a bridge with a load, any conceivable weight or mass are possible outcomes. So the sample space goes from zero to infinity. There's no limit to the number of possible outcomes in this particular experiment. Let's look at another example to illustrate the concept of outcome or outcomes in sample space. Let's say we have this experiment here where three coins are being flipped simultaneously by three different people. Coin one could be heads or tails, coin two could be heads or tails, coin three could be heads or tails. There are eight different possible outcomes from this experiment. Each time the three coins are flipped simultaneously, these are the outcomes that could result. This is our sample space for this experiment. Sample spaces can be very large, depending on the number of different components of the experiment, the number of different possible outcomes that can occur. Each possible outcome, and this is a terminology note, each possible outcome in a sample space is referred to as an element. An event is a subset of the sample space. It's a subset of the different outcomes, a collection of one or more outcomes. And out of this sample space are a number of possible events that could occur. And it's usually what we're looking at is a probability of certain events occurring from our sample space. Out of all the possible outcomes that can occur, what is the probability that certain events will occur? If we're talking about the three coin flip, one of the events would be three heads. Each coin that's flipped comes up heads. We can calculate the probability of each coin coming up a head in the three coin flip. We can calculate the probability that there will be two tails when those three coins are flipped simultaneously, the probability of one tail when the coins are flipped simultaneously, one head or two heads or three tails. We can calculate the probability of occurrence for any of these events, probability of occurrence for any of these events. And so we have experiment, we have that experiment that produces outcomes, and then we can find the probability for different events related to the sample space, or again, sample space is a collection of all outcomes. To calculate the probability, this is the basic simple formula that we would use. And as I said previously, when we're talking about probability, the notation that you see between different textbooks is not that consistent, but this is the notation, this is the approach to notation that we will use in this class. We have the probability of A being some event, equals the number of times that event occurs divided by the number of outcomes in the sample space. So let's look at the probability of three heads occurring in a single experiment where three coins are tossed simultaneously. It's going to be one out of eight. So we look back at our sample space. This only occurs one time out of the eight possible occurrences. So the probability is one out of eight, or 0.125, or it could also be presented as a percentage, 12.5%. Pardon my messy penmanship there. And going back to what we said earlier about probabilities being presented as a ratio, proportion, or a percentage, this is the ratio, proportion, format. And I'm going to do that again. That just looks like something my border collie would do. Try to be a little more careful here and make it look like an actual number. 12.5% percent. My two is kind of ragged, but that's better. And this is the probability presented as a percentage. Here it is presented as a proportion. Here it is as a ratio. Now we can also find the probability for this event, that out of three coins being flipped simultaneously, two of those coins will be tails. And the ratio is 3 out of 8. We know that from our sample space. Let me go back here and identify. We have two tails. Okay, here's two tails. Here's two tails, and here's two tails. So there's three possibilities out of these 8 outcomes. So 3 of 8 equals 0.375 equals 37.5%. For one tail, it's also 3 out of 8. And let's go back and verify that. Okay, one tail. There's one tail. So, yep, 3 out of 8. Then for one head and two heads, it's going to be the same as for one tail and two tails. And then for three tails, it's going to be the same probability that we had for three heads being flipped simultaneously. So hopefully that helps us better understand the concept of outcomes and events. You know, outcome, sample space, and event, and how those are related. Switching gears just a little bit, let's talk about the concept of mutual exclusivity. When we talk about mutual exclusivity, what we're saying is that only one event of all possible events occurs during an experiment. Two events are mutually exclusive if the occurrence of one event prevents the occurrence of another event. Events are mutually exclusive if they have no common elements. Now, it is possible for an experiment to produce overlapping events that are not mutually exclusive. Now, this concept is going to come up again in the other videos. This is just an introduction to this concept, but we have several more videos with this unit, and in those videos we'll talk more about mutual exclusivity with examples. Another concept that you'll see in the other videos is the concept of independent events. The independent events involve the occurrence of an event, and it has no effect on the probability of the occurrence of another event. The occurrence of one event has no effect on the probability of the occurrence of another event. For example, flipping two tails on a three-coin toss has no influence on the probability of other events occurring on the next toss. I mean, we have one flip of three coins, we have the results from that flip, those results have no effect on the next flip. Two events are independent if the occurrence of one event has no influence on the occurrence of the other event. The flip side of independent events is where we run into what we call conditional probability. The events are not independent. The occurrence of one event does affect the probability of other events. For example, if we deal cards from a deck one at a time, the first card dealt, the probability of it being an ace is 4 out of 52. On the first deal, the probability of turning an ace is 4 out of 52, or 0.0769. It's 4 out of 52 because there's 52 cards, 52 possible outcomes, making up our sample space, and there are 4 aces out of those 52 cards. So our probability of turning an ace or pulling an ace where being dealt an ace is 4 out of 52 on that first deal, 0.0769. But if that card was not returned to the deck, what is the probability of turning an ace on the next deal? This is an example of conditional probability. Assuming an ace was turned in the first card that was dealt, and that card is not returned to the deck, what is the probability of turning an ace or being dealt an ace on the next deal? Well, now we only have 3 aces left in the deck, and there are only 51 cards left in the deck. So the probability changes. Instead of 4 out of 52 for that first deal, now it's 3 out of 51. The probability is 0.0588 of being dealt an ace in this particular circumstance. Let's say that no ace was dealt on the first deal. The card that was dealt was not replaced. What is the probability of an ace on the next deal? It's going to be 4 out of 51. The card that was dealt, it doesn't go back into the deck, but there's still 4 aces in the deck. So the probability is 4 out of 51, or 0.0784. Just quick examples of conditional probability. More information in the textbook, and many, many more examples coming in this unit. That was just a quick introduction. In the next video, we're going to take a closer look at the different methods for assigning probabilities: the classical method, the empirical method, and the subjective method. And I'll go ahead and mention now that when we're talking about business operations, the empirical method and the subjective method are the most common methods for assigning probabilities.